CA Department of ASR Women's College to welcome the gathering.
Focus that stubborn thing inside of us that answers that despite all evidence to the contrary, something better awaits us. A blessed morning to one another gathered here. It gives me an immense pleasure to deliver the welcome notes for this wonderful session. On behalf of everyone present here, I cordially welcome our founder and chairman of KSR Educational Institution, line Dr. K. S. Rangaswamy, MD.
Thank you, Linga. Good morning to everyone. Today is the first day of 7-day virtual faculty development program on multidimensional approaches to research in social science organized by PG Department of Commerce, KSR Women's College, Trichambur. It gives me an immense pleasure to introduce and welcome today's resource person, Honorable Dr. D. Kumaresan sir. Dr. D. Kumaresan sir is working director and professor, Department of Commerce, KSR Women's College, Trichambur. He is MCom, MSc, MBA, MA, MPhil, PhD, DLit. He has qualified in SLET and passed the CA final group 2. Kumaresan sir is having 24 years of teaching experience and 19 years of research experience. Sir guided 22 MPhil scholars and guiding 5 PhD scholars in specialization of financial management and marketing management. Our resource person acted as an external examiner in 15 PhD public bivalves examination from various universities. He has worked as a CNET member of Periyar University, Salem. He is a member in Board of Studies, Department of Commerce in various colleges such as Kongo Arts and Science College, Erode, Nehru Memorial College, Trichy, Dr. NGP College of Arts and Science, Coimbatore. He acts as a coordinator in Advisory Committee, ICSSR sponsored research programs. He has worked as a member in editorial board from various journals, such as Inter-Global Journal of Applied Management Science, International Journal of Social and Allied Research, International Journal of Advanced Research in Psychology and Sociology. He is a member in review committee of Indian Journal of Commerce and Management Studies and Cassian Journal of Social Science. He acts as a member of Board of Examiners for PhD thesis evaluation. He also holding other positions like District President in Seva Bharati, President in Swami Vivekananda Sevalaya, etc. He has received various awards and honors, including in recognition of service in the field of higher education, International Economics University for Soft Countries, Republic of Maldives, as honored with the DLit degree. As an appreciation of academic services, India International Friendship Society, New Delhi, has honored with the award of Shiksha Ratan Puraskar. As a token of appreciation for the social services, Best Citizen of India award has been conferred by International Publishing House, New Delhi. Thiruvalluvar Ilakki Award has been conferred by the Indian Academic Researchers Association, Tiruchirappalli, for the outstanding services in Tamil literature. Outstanding New JCI Award has given by the Tech City, JCI, Erode. Swami Vivekananda Award has been conferred by Kamalalayam Trust, Uzhilambetti, Madurai. Kalvi Sudarali Award has been presented by Mahakavi Bharati, Kala Ilakkiya Mandram. Sarah Sudar Award has been conferred on him by Thai Tamil TV YouTube channel. Lifetime Achievement Award in appreciation and recognition of outstanding contribution in the field of teaching, administration, publication, research and development by ESN Publications, Chennai. Distinguished Honor Award for the outstanding performance in teaching and research given by CAP Research Forum, Nagarkoil. He has published 38 papers in edited books at national and international journals. Our chief guest acts as a resource person for 88 conferences, seminars, workshops and symposiums. Guest lecture for 101 motivational and training programs. He has
worked
Mike, you are muted.
Sorry, sir.
No issue.
As presenter, 19 papers in international level, 51 papers in national level, 16 papers in state level, and also 10 workshops. He also interested to rendering the services in society and delivering the spiritual lectures in various temples. I welcome again Dr. T. Kumaresan sir for today's session. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your wonderful words, ma'am. Now the session is handed into a chair. Please, sir.
Sir. Sir, director, sir, your mic is muted, sir.
Sir, director sir, your mic is muted, sir.
Right from the beginning or right now?
Sir, from the beginning, sir.
Okay, let me start once again. The most respected chairman of our college, Honorable Lion Dr. K.S. Rangasamy, sir. Respected Vice Chairman, Mr. R. Srinivasan, sir. Respected Madam Executive Director, Mrs. Kavita Srinivasan, ma'am. Honorable Principal of our college, Dr. M. Karthikeyan, sir. Head of the departments, faculty members, MOC team, and all the participants, a warm and pleasant morning to one and all. At the very outset, yes?
Sir, please turn on your video, sir.
Sir, I have shared. Wait a minute. Is it okay, sir?
Not yet, sir.
Is it okay, sir?
No, sir, I think so. Not yet, sir.
Video?
It's okay, sir. Okay, fine.
Okay. So at the very outset, I'd like to thank the management, principal, faculty members, and all the participants for having given me a wonderful opportunity to share some of my views and ideas about the selection of appropriate statistical tools for data analysis. In the previous day and the other sessions, we have discussed a lot about the significance of review of literature and the significance of questionnaire, how to draft the questionnaire and all we have discussed. So based on the observation during the past 3 days, we have decided to reschedule the session for today, and our resource person, Dr. Dheeraj Kulshrestha, is very kind enough to accept the modification in the schedule, and he has accepted to deliver his address tomorrow. So this session is about the selection of appropriate tools. Let us see how to select the appropriate statistical tools. Sir, is it visible, sir?
Yes, sir.
What about audio? It's okay?
Yes, clear. Yes.
Is the audio okay now?
Yes, sir. Clear, sir, now.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, before going into the topic, let us see a few ideas. What is this water tank? Okay. What is its purpose? The purpose of a water tank is to store the water. Okay. Where is it kept? It is usually kept at the terrace or at the top of the building, top of the house. Whether it is a house or factory or any organization, normally the water tank is kept at the top of the building. Okay. Why it is kept at the top? Then only the water supply will be ensured to all the taps. And moreover, huge volume of water is stored in this water tank for using at home, organizations, institutions, and other buildings. Okay. Now, look at this. What is this water pot? What is the purpose of this water pot? Storing the water. Where is it kept? Usually inside the home. When comparing with the water tank, lesser volume of water is stored so that it can be carried from one place to another Unlike the water tank, it is kept at the top of the building and it is used to store the water only. But this water bath is portable. It can be carried from one place to another. So it is used to store and carry the water. Usually the volume of water kept in this water pot is comparatively and relatively lesser than the water stored in the water tank. Now look at this. What is this water bottle? What is its purpose? Storing and carrying water. Okay. Normally where is it kept? It is kept on the table or in the bag. Yes. What is the purpose? To carry the water. So liters of water can alone be stored here. When comparing with the water pot, only a liter of water can be stored. Half a liter, 1 liter, 1.5 liters, 2 liters, like that. And it can also be carried by the users. It is very useful while traveling from one place to another. Everyone can have a separate water bottle. In the case of water tank, there is only one water tank for the entire home or the entire building. Whereas regarding the water pot, we may have a few water pots at home. Regarding the water bottle, we can have a separate water bottle for everybody at home. Okay. Then what is this water glass? What is its purpose? Carrying and drinking water. So where is it kept? Usually on the top of the pot or in other shelf or table like that. We can use it to drink the water. So when comparing with the pot or bottle, very little volume of water can be stored or carried. Many glasses may be used. Many water glasses may be used to serve water to more persons. So we have seen four types of containers, water containers. Number one, water tank. Number two, water pot. Number three, water bottle. And number four, water glass. Yes, every container is unique in its way. Likewise, we can say every statistical tool is unique in its way. See, as we discussed, in the water tank, huge volume of water is stored. In a water pot, lesser volume of water was preserved or stored or carried. When we come to the water bottle, it is easy to carry. We can carry from one place to another. Even we can keep the water bottle inside our bag or in hands also we can carry easily. But only a limited volume of water, like 1 liter, half a liter or 1.5 liters or 2 liters, like that only can be stored and carried. When we talk about the water glass, about 100 milli or 200 milli liters of water can be carried, stored, or it is used for drinking purposes. Likewise, every statistical tool may be looking like the same, but it has its unique features. It has its unique conditions. So according to that condition or according to that criteria only, a particular statistical tool can be used. Can we say that these containers be alternatively used for different purposes? Can we store a huge volume of water in a water pot or in a water bottle or in a glass of, water glass? No. So huge volume of water can be stored in water tank only. That water tank cannot be used to drink the water. We cannot carry the water tank. Is it not? Likewise, it is not appropriate to use one statistical tool for another purpose. So there is a purpose for every statistical tool. if it is the right tool for this particular analysis, only that statistical tool may be used for that particular purpose or particular analysis. Otherwise, maybe by using any software, we can apply the tool, but it will not be meaningless. I mean, it will not be meaningful, or otherwise, it will not be appropriate. So as we say normally, right man for the right job, it is also applicable for the statistical tools also. We have to follow right tool for the right analysis. Now, before going into the statistical tools, what are the different types of statistical tools and how to select the statistical tools for a particular data analysis, we need to understand what are the different types of data. The data can be broadly classified into three types: nominal, ordinal and scale. Scale data is again be classified into interval data and ratio data. So there are four types of data: nominal, ordinal, interval and ratio. What is nominal data and how does it differ from ordinal data? What is ordinal data? How does it differ from nominal and scale data? Among the scale data, what are the two different types of data? Interval data and ratio data. What is the difference between interval data and ratio data? Let us see one by one. Regarding the nominal data and ordinal data, they are qualitative. Nominal data and ordinal data are qualitative and not quantitative. They are also called as categorical. Nominal data and ordinal data are also called as categorical. But what is the difference between nominal and ordinal? Regarding the ordinal, there is a specific order of arrangement of different groups in the ordinal data. That particular variable is categorized into different groups and there is an order of arranging the groups. Whereas in the case of nominal data, it is a variable which contains different groups and there is no quantitative value, there is no specific order. They are just categorical and just it is merely a name or an identification, like gender. Gender is a variable. It is not quantitative. It is qualitative. That is the categorical variable. The characteristics. The gender is a variable which represents the characteristics of the respondent. So we call it as nominal data. Why do we call it as nominal data? It is a categorical. We can categorize or we can classify the gender into different groups like male, female, transgender, like that we can categorize. But there is no quantitative value for this gender. Gender is a variable, normally we know. It contains no value. It contains no quantitative value. It is just a characteristic. So it is used to identify the respondent, whether he belongs to male category or that particular respondent belongs to female category. So male or female, it is a category, categorical variable. So we call it as categorical data. Similarly, in the case of marital status, we can classify the respondents or we can distribute the respondents into different categories based on the marital status, like married or single, or we can say divorced or widow, married with no children, married with one child, married with two or more children. Like that also we can classify the respondents. So this variable is normally used to just to classify the respondents. It has no quantitative value. It is just a qualitative variable. And moreover, though there is no specific order, see, we assign numbers, no? Number one, male. Number two, female. It can be replaced. It can be interchanged, one for female and two for male. Is it not? There is no impact in rearranging or without having any order, we can assign the identification number. That identification number does not have any quantitative value. So it's just to identify that this respondent is male. This respondent is female. So one represents male. For the purpose of analysis in the statistical software, we are using the numbers. It is just to codify. That's all. It is a code only. That one or two is just a code. It doesn't have any quantitative value. One represents male, two represents female, or one represents female, two represents male. Similarly, in the case of marital status, one represents married, two represents single, or one represents single, two represents married. Like that, we use the coding. That coding is only used to identify the category to which the particular respondents belongs to. That's all. So we call it as nominal data. So nominal data is a qualitative one. That identification coding number or code is just used to identify the category to which the respondents belongs. So it contains no quantitative value. It has no specific order. These data are normally called as categorical data, like gender, marital status, nature of family, area of residence, like that we can see. So this is called nominal data. Then what about ordinal data? As I told you, know, this is also a qualitative data. It has also no value, no quantitative value. But one difference, the basic difference between nominal data and ordinal data is, whereas in the case of nominal data, there is no specific order. But here, it is arranged either in ascending order or in descending order. For example, we are using Likert scale for any particular variable. We are using different items. For example, for analyzing the perception of consumers, we are giving different items, item 1, item 2, item 3, item 4, and so on up to item N. For each and every item, we are giving a statement regarding the perception of consumers towards a particular product. For example, FMCG products we are analyzing means, we are giving different statements. So for each and every statement, we have given Likert scale, as Professor Rao yesterday rightly pointed out. It is always better to provide a 5-point scale so that the result will be accurate. So 5-point scale is used. Strongly agree, agree, neutral, disagree, and strongly disagree. In this case also, we are assigning certain codes. One for strongly disagree, two for neutral, two for disagree, three for neutral, four for agree, and five for strongly disagree. This is just a code. It does not contain any value. We can convert this code as a score. In that case, that score is used to calculate the total score. In case, as I told you, we have given some 15 statements. If we are taking individual statement for analysis, see, for example, first statement you are analyzing separately, second statement you are analyzing separately, third statement, fourth statement, fifth statement, like that, you want to analyze each and every statement separately. In that case, that code assigned is not having any quantitative value. They are just called as ordinal data since it is arranged in an order. The code is assigned in an order, like 5 for strongly agree, 4 for agree, 3 for neutral, 2 for disagree, and 1 for strongly disagree. So here the score, the code is assigned in descending order, is it not? So either it can be arranged in ascending order or descending order, but here we should not change the order. Unlike in the nominal data, as I told you, know, one can be assigned for male and two can be assigned for female. If you don't agree with that, and if you want to interchange the code, you can codify female as 1 and male as 2. There is no impact. But here, if we change the order, say for example, 5 for agree, 4 for neutral, 3 for strongly agree, 4 for strongly disagree, and 1 for strongly agree, 2 for neutral, 3 for strongly disagree, 4 for disagree, 5 for agree, like that, if we collapse the order, it has no meaning. So it should always be arranged, or it is always better to arrange these choices in a particular order, whether it is in ascending order or in descending order. It is better to organize the choices in an order. So only it is called ordinal data. Again, ranking. So for example, first rank, second rank, third rank, fourth rank, fifth rank, sixth rank, like that. That ranking questions or ranking variables are also called as ordinal data. So basically there are two types. One is like Likert scale and another is like ranking question. Sir, what about the age group? Leave the age. We are discussing about the age group. Otherwise another categorical data I can give you, educational level. In the case of educational level, if suppose we are organizing the choices in ascending order, like up to school level, UG level and PG level, only three levels we have given for example, school level, UG level and PG level. So it can be regarded as ordinal data. Why? Because it is arranged in an order. So first choice is low level, that is the school level. Second choice is little higher, that is UG level. When compared with the first choice, it is higher. When compared with the third choice, it is lower. And regarding the third choice, it is the highest of the three choices. So it is arranged in an order. So we call it as ordinal data as well. Suppose if you are taking the occupational status, say for example, businessman, professional, employed, farmer, housewife, student, like that, the educational status or otherwise the occupational status we are using, that is also nominal. Because in that case, that is in the case of occupational status, it is not arranged in any order. That order can be changed. Suppose if you are telling that in your questionnaire, you have mentioned the employed as first choice, businessman as second choice, farmer as third choice, nothing is wrong at all. Another scholar may arrange this like first farmer, second businessman, third professional, fourth employee, fifth housewife, sixth student, like that you can mention. The choices can be arranged like that. So there is no specific order. If there is no specific order, the order can be changed. That is called nominal. Whereas in the case of educational level, as I told you, we have only three choices, means like up to school level, UG level and PG level, it can also be regarded as ordinal data. Whereas suppose you have used one more option like others. Others means it may include any level of education. Say for example, illiterate may also select that particular option. And even a doctorate can select that particular option. ITI complete respondent may also select that particular option. Diploma holder also can select that particular option. So we cannot say that the fourth option is higher than the third option. In that case, that educational level may be considered just as nominal data and not ordinal data. See the difference between nominal data and ordinal data. In the case of nominal data, qualitative, categorical, no quantitative value, no specific order. In the case of ordinal data, it is also qualitative, but there is an order. Here also no quantitative value. Likert scale and ranking questions can be regarded as ordinal data. Now let us come to interval data. Both interval and ratio data are commonly regarded as scale data. Scale means any quantitative value that can be measured. Regarding the qualitative data, there cannot be any quantitative measurement. But in the case of scale data, there can be a qualitative measure. It can be measured in quantitative terms. So scale data is a quantitative data. Ordinal and nominal data are qualitative. It contains no quantitative value. But here, see for example, age is a quantity. How old are you? I am 42 years of old. I am 39 years old. I am 60 years old. I am 15 years old. We are asking, if suppose we have given the question as open-ended, Professor Rao sir yesterday told you, no, closed-ended and open-ended question. In case of open-ended question, we give the freedom to the respondent to mention whatever he thinks, whatever he feels. It may or may not be within one or two words. He can express his feelings in even more than two words. Is it not? So if it is open-ended, the right or the freedom is given to the respondent to mention anything he feels, anything he likes. Likewise, if age is considered, or if we want to consider the age as a scale data, better, it can be an open-ended question. Like age, that's all. No category is to be given. Up to 20 years, 20 to 40 years, 40 to 60 years, above 60 years. Like that, you need not given, or you should not, you need not give, or you should not give any category. If you are giving such categories, it becomes categorical data. It becomes categorical data. And moreover, since it is arranged in an order, we can say that it is an ordinal data. In a sense, age, if it is given in age group, that age group may be considered as ordinal data since it is a categorical variable. We have categorized the age into 3, 4, or 5 categories like that. So it can be regarded as categorical data. Suppose if the exact age is collected, open-ended question is given, no category is given, no choice is given for the respondent. So it is open-ended. So he fills the age. What is his age? 26, 33, 41, 67, 18, like that he is filling. So it is a scale data. It is a quantitative data. In the quantitative data or in the scale data, there are again two categories. One is interval data and another is ratio data. Now we are discussing about the interval data. What is an interval data? It is a quantitative, okay. There is an order, okay. But the main difference between interval data and ratio data is, for the interval data, there is no fixed origin or there is no true zero. True zero cannot be there. For example, temperature. There must be some value of temperature. See, 98 degree Fahrenheit, or 30 degree Celsius, 20 degree Celsius, minus 1 degree Celsius, minus 10 degree Celsius. We can say anything, but we can never say that there is 0 degree Celsius temperature, cannot be there. In fact, really, so that is called interval data. There can be some fixed distance, 2 degree Celsius, 3 degree Celsius, 4 degree Celsius, 10 degree Celsius, that distance can be measured. So there is a fixed distance between one choice and another, or between one value and another. So this is called interval data. So most probably the interval data is like temperature only, because that temperature alone has no true value, true zero value, or no fixed origin. We can never say that this is the origin, this is the centroid. Zero value cannot be there. For temperature, we can never say, now it is 0 degree Celsius, we can never say. Even it can be measured as minus 0.1 degree also can be measured. But 0 degree cannot be measured. So at least some value will be there. Value will be there. Is it not? So it is called as interval data. Then come to ratio data. Here, quantitative. It is also quantitative. It is arranged in an order. See, here there is a fixed origin. Unlike in the case of interval data, there was no fixed origin. There is no 0 degree Celsius. At least some temperature will be there. At least some weather will be there. But no 0 degree weather. No 0 degree temperature. But here, there can be true value of 0. What is your income? Sir, I have no income. Do you have any experience? Sir, I have no experience. I have 0 years of experience. Do you have any income? No, sir. My income is 0, sir. We can say like that, no. There is a fixed origin. What is your experience? Sir, I don't have any experience, sir. I am a fresher, sir. That means, that is the origin. How much are you earning? Sir, I am studying as a student. So I don't have any income, sir. So your income will be started and there is an origin of your origin for your income only when you start earning. So till then your income will be zero, your experience will be zero. So there can be a true value of zero, and here also the income can be arranged in order, the experience can be arranged in order. There could also be some fixed distance. So these data can be regarded as quantitative data. So it is combinedly known as ratio data. See the difference between interval data and ratio data. Both are quantitative, both are in an order, both have a fixed distance. The only difference is in the case of interval data, there is no fixed origin, but in the case of ratio data, there is a fixed origin. If the income is obtained as open-ended question, as open-ended question, like what is your income? What is your monthly income? One writes 10,000, another writes 15,000, another writes 20,000, another writes 18,996. Like that, anything can be said. That's why Rao sir said it is not advisable to have open-ended questions for many variables. It can be used for one or two variables because the responses may be more. You cannot identify, you cannot use it, isn't it? But in some cases, we need scale data. We need scale data. So here also, we can categorize the income up to rupees 10,000, 10,001 to 20,000, 20,001 to 30,000, above 30,000, like that also we can categorize. If we categorize the income, then it can be considered as categorical data. So it can either be considered as ratio data or it can be considered as categorical data depending upon the response we obtain from the response. So that is the basis for determining whether this particular variable is a nominal data, ordinal data or scale data. In the case of scale, we have again interval and ratio data. For determining or for selection of appropriate tools, we must be familiar with this type of variable. Nominal, ordinal, interval and scale. If you are able to understand the category of data or the type of data, then we'll be easily applying or easily selecting the appropriate statistical tool. Now we shall go to the data analytical tools. What are the different types of tools? When can we apply any particular statistical tool, or when we should not apply any particular statistical tool? See, the statistical tools can be basically divided into two types: parametric tests and non-parametric tests. These are the two basic types of tests, and these two have certain differences. What are the distinguishing features? In the case of distribution of data, if the data is normally distributed, then only we can apply parametric test. Understand? My dear friends, parametric tests can be applied only when the data are normally distributed. What do you mean by normal distribution? In the case of normal distribution, the curve will be symmetric. The curve will be in bell shape or symmetric. If it is symmetric, we can say that the data is normally distributed. By using the statistical package like SPSS, we can test the normality of the data using different tests. Different types of tests can be used to examine whether the data are normally distributed or not. If the data are actually normally distributed, we can apply the parametric tests. While applying the statistical package, the normality can be tested and it is said to be approximately normally distributed, not accurately normally distributed. Whether the data is normally distributed or not can be tested using several tests in SPSS, and the result can say that the data is approximately normally distributed. So we need not confirm whether it is accurately normally distributed or not. So sometimes there could be some that curve may be somehow or little different from the exact bell shape. It's not. So that is called normally distributed data. Suppose you test the normality and you find that it is not normally distributed. From the review of literature, from the expert opinion, or from your research supervisor, you want to apply parametric test alone, but you find that the data is normally distributed, not normally distributed. I told you parametric test can be applied only when the data is normally distributed, but you find that it is not normally distributed. Then what we can do? You can convert the not normally distributed data into normally distributed data using different methods. By taking log to your data for each and every respondent, you take the logarithm. By using the logarithm value, you can convert the not normally distributed data into normally distributed data. Likewise, we have different methods. And suppose, sir, if my data cannot be normally distributed data, even if, as you said, if I take logarithm and I could not find that the data is not normally distributed data, what can I do, sir? Better you can go for non-parametric tests. Does it mean that the non-parametric test can be applied for the data not normally distributed alone? It is not like that. See here, for any data, we can apply non-parametric test. For both normally distributed data as well as the not normally distributed data, non-parametric tests can be applied. Whereas in the case of parametric tests only, normality must be there. Then type of data. In the case of parametric tests, normally the variable is either a ratio data or interval data. That is the dependent variable. For the dependent variable, the data type must be either ratio or interval. In most of the cases, we are using ratio. As I told you, the interval data is very little. The scope of interval data is very minimum. So most of the cases, we have ratio data. Whereas in the case of non-parametric tests, it can either be nominal or ordinal. What is the central measure of temporal tendency used in the case of parametric tests? Normally it is mean. In the case of non-parametric tests, it is median. what are the benefits in the case of parametric tests, we can draw so many conclusions. But in the case of non-parametric tests, it is very limited. So simplicity less affected by outliers. Then the tests, we have different types of tests. We will discuss one by one in the coming slides. Now let us see parametric tests. Parametric tests can be basically divided into two. Dear participants, could you please mute your mic?
Professors, please. Okay, sir.
Am I audible now?
Yes,
sir. Am I audible, sir? Okay, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So now let us discuss about the parametric test. It is very simple. What do you mean by parametric test? I can give you the simplest definition. Even it may look like humor, but it is the fact. What do you mean by parametric test? If any parameter is used, that test is known as parametric test. Very simple. If no parameter is used, then it is said to be non-parametric test. Then you will be asking, sir, what do you mean by parameter? Obviously, it is the next question. Yes, let me tell you, what is a parameter? It is just like mean, standard deviation and variance. Mean, standard deviation and variance. These are strong parameters. These are strong parameters. Whereas median is also a parameter. It is a weak parameter. That's why we used it in non-parametric test and not in parametric test. So in the case of parametric test, we are using any of these strong parameters like mean, standard deviation or variance. Variance is nothing but the square of standard deviation. So basically parametric test can be divided into two groups only. T-test and ANOVA, that's all. T-test and ANOVA. In the case of T-test, we should understand certain basic criteria when we can apply T-test. We know dependent variable and independent variable. As Professor told you yesterday, there could be some dependent variable and independent variable. In the case of independent variable, it is a nominal or ordinal data and contains a maximum of two groups only. Understand? In the case of parametric test, we have t-test and ANOVA. In the case of t-test, particularly with regard to independent variable, there must be, there could be, there should be a maximum of two groups only. Like in the case of gender, gender is an independent variable. It contains two groups only. If we are giving two choices only, then we can apply t-test for this variable. Nature of family. Joint family and nuclear family. There are two choices only, two groups only. Marital status, married and single, two groups only. We can apply t-test. And at the same time, we have to understand that the dependent variable is a scale data. Independent variable is a nominal or ordinal data. Dependent variable is a scale data. Dear participant, could you mute your mic? Could you please mute your mic? Okay. So dependent variable. In the case of dependent variable, it is a scale data. So there are two variables. One is independent variable and another is dependent variable. For applying t-test, there is a condition that the dependent variable must be a scale data. Independent variable may be either nominal or ordinal, but there must be a maximum of two groups only. So example for nominal data, that is independent variable, gender, marital status and nature of family. Regarding the example for dependent variable, marks obtained, height of students, weight of students, like that. Suppose if the independent variable contains more than two groups, like age up to 20 years, 20 to 40 years, 40 to 60 years, above 60 years, educational level, school level, UG level, PG level, area of residence, urban, semi-urban, like that, it contains more than two groups. You should never apply t-test. It is appropriate to apply ANOVA only and not the t-test. So in the case of t-test, either there is a single group or two groups of independent variable. Either all the respondents are considered as a single group or they are categorized into two groups. And of course, the dependent variable is a scale data. Then we can apply t-test. Whereas in the case of ANOVA, all other conditions are same. That means the dependent variable must be a scale data, ratio or interval, like marks, height and weight. We have got exact marks, 56, 83, 94, 29, like that we have got the marks, height, 64 feet or in centimeters, 86 centimeters, 96 centimeters, 100 centimeters, like that, weight, 20 kilo, 40 kilograms, 69 kilograms, like that. So it is a scale data. Regarding the independent variable, it is a nominal or ordinal, okay, but it contains more than two groups. In that case, we can apply ANOVA. So understand, what is the difference between t-test and ANOVA? Where can we apply t-test and where can we apply ANOVA? Now let us see different types of t-test. Number one, one sample t-test. Number one, one sample t-test. Number two, independent samples t-test. Number three, paired samples t-test. What are the different types of t-test? One sample t-test, independent samples t-test and paired samples t-test. So what about the z-test, sir? Sir, t-test can be applied only for small samples which we have studied earlier. And now you are discussing about the t-test only. What about, sir? What about z-test, sir? Since the data is normally distributed, and if you look at the table, you know, in the case of normally distributed data, the curve is bell-shaped. It is symmetrical. So at a stage, it becomes saturated. The curve will be looking like this. It's a bell shape. A peak will be there, then there will be a fall. At one stage, it becomes saturated, there will be a straight line. So what does it mean? After a particular stage, the value becomes constant. Applies t-test only even for a large sample, so it does not make any difference. So we are discussing about the t-test only. So one sample t-test, independent samples t-test and paired samples t-test are the different types of t-test. Whereas in the case of ANOVA, one-way ANOVA, two-way ANOVA, MANOVA, ANOCOVA and MANOCOVA. There are five types of ANOVA. One-way, two-way, MANOVA, ANOCOVA and MANOCOVA. Let us discuss one. See, regarding the one sample t-test. So here there is only one sample. The entire all the respondents are not categorized. They are considered as a single sample. No categorization is made. Then what else is done? We are comparing the sample parameter with the population parameter. So in the case of population, population mean is considered as the parameter, and in the case of sample, we have the sample mean is considered as the parameter. Sample mean and population mean are compared. So here, since we are comparing the population mean, the population mean must be known. Then only we can apply one sample t-test. Otherwise, we should not apply the one sample t-test. So, for what purpose or for any example, we can use the one sample t-test. See, there is a college. We know the overall performance of the college, and there is a particular department. So like KSR College, the whole college is there. Commerce department is there. Our department head says that our department has performed better than the overall performance of the college. In that case, to prove whether the contention of the HOD is right or not, whether the statement given by the argued by the head of the department is true or not, to verify that or to ensure that, we are applying one sample t-test. So here we know the sample mean, the department performance we know, overall performance of the college we know. In that case, we are comparing the overall performance with the sample performance, or population parameter with the sample parameter, population mean with the sample mean. All the respondents are not categorized, they are considered as single sample. In that case, we can apply one sample t-test. Then what about the independent samples t-test? In the case of one sample t-test, yes.
Sir, ஏதாவது மார்க்கெட்டிங் உள்ள எக்ஸாம்பிள் சொல்லுங்களேன் சார் ஒன் சாம்பிள் டி டெஸ்ட்டுக்கு
ஒன் சாம்பிள் டி டெஸ்ட் ஓகே
அது ஒன்றும் பெட்டரா இருக்கும் எனக்கு அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் பண்ணிக்க அதுக்காக
லெட் மீ டெல் யூ லைக் லைக் டிபார்ட்மெண்ட் இன் எனி கம்பெனி சேல்ஸ் வால்யூம் இஸ் தேர் தேர் ஆர் டிஃபரண்ட் ஜோன்ஸ் லைக் ஈஸ்ட் ஜோன் வெஸ்ட் ஜோன் நார்த் ஜோன் அண்ட் சவுத் ஜோன் த கம்பெனி வாண்ட்ஸ் டு நோ which zone has performed better. Say for example, we are in the south zone. So whether the south zone's performance is better or not, in that case, the whole performance of the performance of the whole company is known. That is called population mean, is it not? And the average turnover of the south zone alone is compared with the company's overall performance. In that case, we can apply one sample t-test. Okay, madam? Do you understand?
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Now, independent sample t-test. Now, the respondents are divided into two groups. Like in the case of nominal data, I told you, no? Nominal data, male and female. Boys and girls. In our class, there are two sections. I mean, boys and girls students. Is it not? In that case, if we want to compare the performance of boys and girls, in the case of t-test, I told you there could be a maximum of two groups only. In the case of one sample t-test, there was only one group. But now there are two groups. Like, suppose if you are capturing the dealers of your company, is it not? There can be male dealer and female dealer, is it not? So what is the performance made by male dealers, and what is the performance of female dealers? Is there any relationship, or is there any significant difference between the performance of male dealers and female dealers? So if there is any categorization like this, there are two groups, there are two groups maximum, and these two categories are compared. Sample mean, sample one mean is compared with the sample two mean. Like as I told you, the example, one department performance is compared with another department. One zone's performance is compared with another zone. One area performance is compared with another area. So what is the performance of dealers in Erode district, and what is the performance of dealers in Coimbatore district? So the all the dealers of Erode district are considered as one sample, and all the dealers in Coimbatore district are considered as another sample. So two groups are there. In that case, we can apply independent sample t-test. Independent means the element of one group cannot be a member of another group. Like a dealer in Erode district cannot be a member in Coimbatore district, is it not? So it is called independent. So it can also be regarded as mutually exclusive. So in that case, we can apply independent sample state test. Then comes the third one, paired sample state test. Here also, there is only one group. Unlike in the case of independent sample state test, in that case, we have categorized the respondents into two groups, but here they are not categorized. Like one sample state test, here also, there is only one sample. But the data are obtained for two different periods. So before a particular event and after a particular event. See, for example, now we are in the lockdown. Lockdown means our grocery purchases, for example, or our income before lockdown and after lockdown. Our grocery purchases before lockdown and after lockdown. Like that we can categorize for the same families. For example, if you are taking 25 families in a particular locality, in Tiruchengodu, we have considered 25 families. What was their average income before lockdown? What is their average income after lockdown? In that case, see, the sample is same. The same respondents are considered. They are all considered as a single sample. But the data are obtained for before and after. In that case, we have to apply paired sample state test. So the parameter is sample mean before and sample mean after. Likewise, in the case of a college, department performance before a particular training or after a particular training, they can be compared to determine whether the training has an impact on performance or not. Like then we come to what?
Sir?
Yes?
Sir, before and during Kollama, sir?
Always sir, better before-
Your mic is mute.
Right. So we can apply for before and during, pre and during, pre and post. For that, two types of for two different periods, we can apply paired sample status. But normally, we are applying before and after only. Okay. So during the particular event means we cannot decide whether that event has an impact or not. For that purpose only, better we can compare before and after. That's all. Okay. Then come to ANOVA. ANOVA can be divided into two, univariate and multivariate. Univariate and multivariate. In the case of multivariate, you see the first letter is M. M stands for multivariate. ANOVA, MANOVA. ANOVA is univariate and MANOVA is multivariate. ANAKOVA is univariate. MANAKOVA is multivariate. What is ANOVA? Analysis of variance. I told you what is a variance. Variance is the square of standard deviation. So what is ANOVA? Analysis of variance. What is MANOVA? Multiple analysis of variance. So that is called MANOVA. Then what is ANAKOVA? Analysis of covariance. In this case also it is univariate. Then MANAKOVA, multiple analysis of covariance. Okay. Now what is covariance? Covariance is another variable. It is also a scale data that is correlated with the dependent variable. I told you, no, independent variable and dependent variable. Dependent variable is the testing variable. This covariate variable is correlated with the dependent variable. Both the dependent variable and covariate variables are scale data. For example, university examination marks is a dependent variable. University examination marks is a dependent variable. Then what is a covariate variable? Model exam marks. Model exam marks may support the university exam marks. Why? Because we are conducting the model examination to improve the performance of the university, performance of the students in the university exam. So there could be some correlation between, and not some correlation, to a great extent of correlation. There could be a great extent of correlation between model exam marks and university exam marks. In that case, university exam mark is considered as the dependent variable and model exam mark can be considered as a covariate variable along with another variable that is independent variable. That is different, right? Say for example, specialization is considered. Specialization, see finance, marketing, like that, specialization is there. Specialization is independent variable. Marks in university exam is dependent variable. Now let us see one by one. In the case of univariate variable, that is one-way ANOVA, we are considering only one independent variable. In the case of one-way ANOVA, we are considering only one independent variable. So nominal or ordinal. The independent variable is nominal or ordinal. We are considering only one independent variable and only one dependent variable. Only one independent variable and only one dependent variable. Independent variable is nominal or ordinal. It contains more than two groups. T-test and not the ANOVA. So the condition required for applying ANOVA is the general condition. The independent variable must contain more than two groups. It applies here also. So only one independent variable and only one dependent variable. Dependent variable is a scale data and independent variable may be either nominal or ordinal. It contains more than two groups. In that case, we have to apply one-way ANOVA. What is two-way ANOVA? See, just only one difference. Instead of only one independent variable, we are using two independent variables, but only one dependent variable. univariate means only one dependent variable. One way ANOVA, only one independent variable and one dependent variable. Two way ANOVA, two independent variables and one dependent variable. See the difference, right? So for example, as you asked, we can have some retailers, for example, dealers, distributors and stockists. The company has appointed three types of retailers: dealers, distributors and stockists. Now the turnover is compared. So turnover is a scale data. It is the dependent variable. The type of retailer is an independent variable. It is an independent variable. It is a nominal data. Retailer, type of retailer, dealer, distributor and stockist. So there are three categories, more than two categories, that condition satisfied. Only one independent variable. What is it? Type of retailer and only one dependent variable. What is it? Turnover. It is a scale data. That condition is also satisfied. So we can apply one way ANOVA. Whereas in the case of two way ANOVA, we are comparing the turnover. One categorical variable, that is one independent variable, is a type of retailer. Okay. Then suppose type of retailer and zone, east zone, west zone, north zone and south zone, that is also compared. So two independent variables, is it not? First independent variable, type of retailer, it has three categories, is it not? Dealer, distributor and stockist. In the case of zone, there are four categories and the dependent variable is turnover. In that case, we can apply two-way ANOVA. So that is the difference between one-way ANOVA and two-way ANOVA. Then come to MANOVA. Here, see the difference. In the case of one-way ANOVA, we had only one independent variable. In there are only two independent variables. But here, it can either be one or more independent variables. It is nominal or ordinal. Independent variable contains more than two groups. All are same conditions. But the next condition is different. That is, in the case of MANOVA, that is multi-ANOVA, multi-analysis of variance, there are two or more dependent variables. There are two or more dependent variables. In the previous example, I told you about the turnover. Suppose if you are comparing the quantity of, say, how many units have been sold. Turnover is the total value of sales. So here we are comparing the volume of sales. How many units have been sold? How many tons of sold? Like that. Turnover value, turnover volume is compared. It is also quantitative. So it is also a scale data. Irrespective of the number of independent variables, whether we can compare one independent variable only, or two or more independent variables may be compared. But condition for applying MANOVA is there must be two or more dependent variables. In this case, I told you turnover value, turnover volume, then why not the selling and distribution expenses, marketing expenses, or administrative expenses, or advertising expenses, like selling and distribution expenses, I told you, no. Like that we are comparing. They are all considered as dependent variable. They are all scale data. They are all scale data. In that case, we can apply MANOVA. So see the difference between one-way ANOVA, two-way ANOVA and MANOVA. Then let us go to ANOCOVA. I told you, apart from two variables, that is independent variable and dependent variable, one more additional variable is included, that is covariate variable that has a strong correlation with the dependent variable. Both the dependent variable and the covariate variable are scale data. The example I told you, university exam marks. It is a scale data and dependent variable. Covariate variable that may be the model exam marks. In the previous example, I told you about the turnover volume, and the expenses we have discussed. If suppose there is any correlation between selling and distribution expenses and turnover, there is a strong correlation between selling and distribution expenses and turnover, then we can say that the selling and distribution expenditure is a covariate variable. In that case, instead of applying MANOVA, we can apply ANOCOVA. So there is only one dependent variable here. Only either turnover value or turnover volume can be used. Then selling and distribution expenditure is a covariate variable since it is highly correlated with the turnover. Then independent variable, as I told you, the same, like type of retailer or zone or the area, like district, region, whatever classification they have made. So this is the case where we can apply ANOCOVA. So wherever we have A as the first letter, ANOVA or ANOCOVA, it is a univariate variable. It means there must be only one dependent variable. Wherever we have M as the first letter, MANOVA or MANOCOVA, it is a multivariate analysis. In that case, more than one dependent variable is used. So this is about ANOCOVA. Then come to MANOCOVA. In the case of MANOCOVA, all the conditions are same except one condition, that is here two or more dependent variables are used. In the case of ANOCOVA, only one dependent variable. In the case of MANOCOVA, since it is a multivariate analysis, there may be two or more dependent variables. Like as I told you in the previous example itself, turnover value and turnover volume. Both are considered as dependent variables. And what is the covariate variable? There can be one or more covariate variable. Administration, selling and distribution expenses. Or sometimes the sales commission. Is it not? It is also included in the selling and distribution expenses. Suppose if we have different data like selling commission or distribution and delivery man charges, like that, if we are comparing these two, and these two have highly correlated with the turnover value as well as the turnover volume. In that case, type of retailer and zone, so there are one or more dependent variables and they are nominal. They contain more than two groups. Okay, there are two or more dependent variables, turnover value, turnover volume, two or more covariate variables, salesman commission, delivery van charges. Suppose, see, nowadays free door delivery is made. Based on that, the turnover increases, so delivery van charges or delivery van expenditure has high level correlation with the turnover. So why not it be considered as covariate variable? salesman commission. If you are giving more incentive to the salesman, he will be working to improve the sales, so that there also can be some high level correlation between salesman commission and the turnover. So in this case we can apply Manakova, right? So that's all about the parametric test. Can be basically classified into t-test and ANOVA. T-test can be divided into three: one sample t-test, independent sample t-test, and paired sample t-test. Whereas in the case of ANOVA, one-way ANOVA, two-way ANOVA, MANOVA, ANOKOVA, and MANAKOVA. Then the next tool we can apply is correlation. Correlation can be divided into two, that is simple correlation and multiple correlation. See here, in the case of correlation, there is no dependent variable or independent variable. The variables are considered as interdependent variable. Variable A is dependent on B. B is dependent on A. So there is a reciprocal relationship. There is a reciprocal dependence between a variable 1 and variable 2. If there are only two variables compared, it is said to be simple correlation. And if more than two variables are compared, it is said to be multiple correlation. So the measure used for analyzing the data is called coefficient of correlation. That is correlation coefficient. Say for example, again, in the case of the turnover by salesman A, turnover by salesman B is compared for every month from January to December. Like the same thing, turnover by salesman B from month A, I mean in between the sales made by salesman A and salesman B. For that purpose we are using the correlation. See here, we have to understand that the measure is coefficient of correlation. It is expressed coefficient of correlation. Its range is normally or must be between -1 and +1. So -1 and +1. If the sign is negative, if the sign is minus, we can say that the correlation is negative between two variables. If the sign is plus, we can say that the two variables are positively correlated. So what is positive correlation? If the variables move in the same direction, it is said to be positive correlation. If the variables move in opposite direction, it is said to be negative correlation. For example, again, as I told you, now we are comparing the advertisement expenditure and sales. If advertisement expenditure is increased and the sales value is also increased, so both are increased, both are increased, in that case the variables are said to be moving in the same direction. If the advertisement is decreased, sales is also decreased, in that case also we can say that both are moving in the same direction. Either upwards or downwards, both are moving upwards and both are moving downwards, we can say that it is positively correlated. Since they are moving, both are moving downwards, we cannot say that that is negatively correlated. Also, it is positively correlated. Then what about negative correlation? In that case, the variables move in opposite directions. That is, one variable increases and another decreases. Or one variable variable decreases and another in that case it is said to be negatively correlated. So the sign indicates the direction of change. So the correlation can be applied to test the relationship between two or more variables considered for the study. So normally we are using Karl-Pearson's coefficient of correlation. Karl-Pearson's coefficient of correlation. So if marks are compared, if turnover is compared, if sales expenditure is compared, they are scale data. They are scale data. We are using Karl-Pearson's coefficient of correlation. If suppose instead of comparing the marks, if you are comparing the rank, in that case we have to apply Spearman's rank correlation coefficient. See, correlation is a linear relationship. If the data is continuous, that is ratio scale, continuous or ratio scale, see, like marks, turnover, expenditure, I told you, know they are scale data. We are using scatter diagram and Karl-Pearson's coefficient of correlation is used. That is in the case of ranks. As I told you, rank is an ordinal scale. In that case, we have to apply Spearman's rank correlation coefficient. Then, if suppose the variable is in the nominal scale, then we have to apply Yule's coefficient of association, that is Q, is used. So this is about the correlation. Then come to regression. Regression is somehow different from correlation. In the case of correlation, we can understand the extent of relationship between two variables, right? Degree of relationship between variable 1 and variable 2. That's what we can understand. But by applying the regression analysis, we can find out the unknown value with the known value. In the case of correlation, I told you the variables are interdependent. But in the case of regression, one variable is considered as dependent and it is also called as response variable. There could be one or more independent variables. They are called explanatory variables or factors, or sometimes they are regarded as regressors. So what is response variable? It is a dependent variable or outcome variable. So outcome variable has to be quantitative. Outcome variable must be quantitative.
Professor, please mute your mic. Professor, please.
Okay. So the outcome must be quantitative, but the factors can either be quantitative or categorical. That is different. Understand? There is some misconception about the independent variable. That is the factors. Among the scholars, that is, the factors can either be quantitative or categorical for applying regression models. Only thing is, the outcome variable or the response variable must be quantitative. Here also, if you are comparing one explanatory variable and one response variable, it is said to be simple correlation. If more than one explanatory variables and one response variable is considered, it is said to be multiple regression. So there is only one difference between simple regression and multiple regression. So this can be applied. See, for example, turnover is considered as dependent variable. The same example I'm telling you. For example, the turnover is considered as response variable. Okay. For increasing the turnover, we have taken a lot of initiatives. see advertisement in television or special advertisement campaign is being conducted, or sometimes we have appointed a marketing manager, marketing supervisor, marketing executive, like that, and we are giving incentives to the dealers, distributors, stockists, like that. Now we want to know, there are several explanatory variables. Among these explanatory variables, which of these explanatory variables is contributing more towards the turnover? That is response variable or dependent variable. To determine that, we are using the regression model. Okay, then suppose in the case of regression, see, in the case of one-way ANOVA, only one independent variable was considered. In the case of two-way ANOVA, only two independent variables were considered. In the case of MANOVA, we used more than two independent variables. In the case of regression also, more than two independent variables are compared. More than two factors were compared, or the explanatory variables were compared. But it is advisable to apply regression when you have some 5 or 6 regressors or explanatory variables. It is by experience only I am telling you, there is no specific criteria that the regression can be used only when there are up to 6 explanatory variables. There is no such criteria. But based on the previous experience, I am telling you that we can apply multiple regression when there are up to 5 or 6 explanatory variables. If suppose more variables are there, some 15 variables, some 20 variables, so large set of variables are there, how can I analyze, sir? Or what is the appropriate tool to be applied for that case? In that case, we can apply the factor analysis. In this case, relatively large set of variables are compressed into smaller set of factors that are used to represent the original variables as linear combinations of smaller set of factors. So linear combination can be made simple when there is a smaller set of factors. If 20 factors or 30 factors are there, it is difficult to understand the linear combination between the factors and the response variable. So if the large set of variables are used, better you can go for factor analysis. So one-way ANOVA is extended to two-way ANOVA. Two-way ANOVA is extended to simple regression and multiple regression. So its extension is factor analysis, and factor analysis can be divided into two. One is exploratory factory analysis and the other is confirmatory factory analysis. There are two types of factor analysis. One is exploratory and the other is confirmatory factory analysis. Now we should understand, when can we apply exploratory factory analysis and the situation where we can apply confirmatory factory analysis? Yes, I told you, no, we have large set of variables, large set of constructs, but we do not know the nature of constructs. See, for example, I told you that exponentially variables. You have some 20 variables, and you do not know how to categorize these variables. I told you factor analysis is used mainly to reduce the dimension, because linear combination cannot be made between large set of variables and the response variable or dependent variable. So if you want to compare, or if you want to understand the linear relationship between these large set of variables and one dependent variable, better we can this variable can be grouped. Group these large set of variables, then we have to apply exploratory factor analysis. By applying factor analysis, exploratory factor analysis, the entire 20 variables are grouped into 4, 5 or 6 factors by the factor analysis, by the exploratory factor analysis, and we need to explain which factor is contributing more, which factor is contributing least. Like that we can see based on the results. But whereas in the case of confirmatory factor analysis, we know the predicted way. We are able to understand how to categorize these constructs. And if these specified constructs are to be tested, whether they are in the predicted way or not. That is, to confirm whether the categorization of constructs by ourselves is correct or not. To confirm that, we have to apply Kani factor analysis. So that can be made by using the structural equation modeling, any other the path coefficient model like that. So this is what about the type of factor analysis. So the next one is discriminant analysis. Here also we have multiple discriminant analysis. It is better or considered appropriate to use this technique where the dependent variable is a categorical variable. See the difference. It is entirely different from all the previous cases, previous tools what we have discussed so far. In all these cases, the condition variable must be a scale data. It is a ratio scale, okay, nominal or non-metric. So that is the only difference where we can apply discriminant analysis. Regarding the independent variable, they are metric. See the difference. In previous cases, nominal or ordinal, and the dependent variable must be scale data. But the dependent variable is non-metric and independent variables are metric. See here, examples, as I told you, the gender, male and female, heavy users versus light users, purchasers and non-purchasers, good credit risk and poor credit risk, members and non-members, attorney, physician or professor. These could be regarded as dependent variable. See, high users and light users, highly satisfied people, consumers, and low level satisfied consumers. high users and low users. So that is called dependent variable, and that is a categorical data. In this case, we have to apply discriminant analysis. So this is the difference between other tools and the discriminant analysis. It is a peculiar and specific. It is different from all other tools. Then we come to non-parametric tests. There are basically five non-parametric tests: Mann-Whitney-Hugh test, Driscoll-Wallis test, Wilcoxon-W test, Friedman test, and chi-square test. There is a question among some scholars whether the chi-square test is a parametric or non-parametric. Certainly, I am telling you that this is a non-parametric test because we are not using any such quantitative data. Right? Now, let us see one by one. Mann-Whitney-Hugh test. It is very simple. It is almost similar to the independent sample status. So we call it as non-parametric equivalent to independent sample status. What were the conditions there? Independent variable must contain a maximum of two groups. In the case of independent sample t-test, there were only two groups. Here also, there are two groups. The independent variable contains two groups only. If more than two groups, we should not apply Mann-Whitney-Hugh test. But what is the difference between independent samples t-test and Mann-Whitney t-test? In the case of independent samples t-test, the dependent variable was scale data. But here, dependent variable is ordinal data. I told you about the turnover. Is it not? If turnover is compared, it is scale data, then we have to apply the the independent sample t-test. Suppose if the turnover is graded, for example, high turnover, medium turnover, and low level turnover, high productivity, medium productivity, and low productivity, in that case, productivity or turnover is dependent variable, but it is given in an ordinal scale. So ordinal data, in that case, we have to apply Mann-Whitney-Hugh test. If turnover is compared, we have to apply independent sample status. If grades of turnover is compared, we have to apply Mann-Whitney-Hugh test. So it is called as non-parametric equivalent to independent sample status. Then come to Driscoll-Wallis test. It is regarded as non-parametric equivalent to one-way ANOVA. In that case, independent variable contains more than two groups. Here also the condition is same. So what is the difference? As in the previous case, the dependent variable was scale data, but here dependent variable is ordinal data. The same example we can take. Productivity level, instead of taking productivity or instead of taking turnover, we are assessing the turnover level or productivity level or performance level, low, medium, high. But more than two groups, see the difference between Mann-Whitney and Driscoll-Wallis. If only two groups are there, we have to apply Mann-Whitney-Hugh test. If more than two groups are here, see, like as I told you, dealers, distributors, and stockists. In this case, we have to apply Driscoll-Wallis test. So that is the main difference between Mann-Whitney test and Driscoll-Wallis test. Then the next one is Wilcoxon test. It is similar to paired sample state test. In the case of paired sample state test, all the samples, all the respondents are considered as a single sample, and we compared the data between two periods. Similarly, here also we are comparing the data of the same sample between two periods, but the difference is again the dependent variable is ordinal instead of scale data. So here productivity level before training and productivity level after training. if a comparison is made, see, your company is there, the company wants to increase the productivity level of the employees, so the company is offering a training program, and if the company wants to know whether after training the employees have improved their performance, in that case the productivity level before the training and after the training are compared, and the productivity level is graded low, medium and high. If production is compared, for example, monthly 1000 units, monthly 2000 units are quantities, in that case we have to apply parity sample stick test. If grade is compared, like low, medium, high, in that case we have to apply Wilcoxon test. Then Friedman's ranking test, like the Spearman's correlation coefficient, I told you, no? In the case of correlation, we compared the marks. In the case of Spearman's correlation coefficient, we compared the ranks. But it is advisable to apply the Spearman's rank correlation coefficient if there are some two judges or three judges. In that case, it will be better. But in the case of K-related measures, several variables. See, for example, a company introduces a new model of car. The company has introduced a new model of car, and the company wants to know the feedback or ranking of the features of the car by the customers. The company is distributing a feedback form, and they are asking the respondents, the customers, to rank the features like price, model, interiors, technological features, is it not, mileage, like that. So several features are given, and the customers were asked to rank the features. Or otherwise, sometimes, see, nowadays you are using the different digital payment methods, is it not? We are using the net banking, we are using mobile banking, we are using some Google Pay or Phone Pay, some AEPS, the other based enabled other enabled payment system is there. Then several devices are used at the point of sale, is it not? And micro ATMs are there, ATMs are there, so many digital payment methods are there, and we want to know the best method or most widely used method of digital payments, and we are asking our respondents to rank these things according to their perception. We want to test whether the which is the most widely used or most widely preferred digital payment method. In that case, several variables are there, more responses are there. So instead of using Spearman's rank correlation, we are using the Friedman test. Similarly, we can apply Henry Garrett ranking also. We can apply Henry Garrett ranking also. That is different. So that is a similar test which can be used. So that's all about the Friedman test, rank test. And finally, we have chi-square test. This test is used to test the goodness of fit or to test the independence of variables, that is the association of attributes. So here the variables are nominal or ordinal. So where can we apply? See, nowadays we are suffering from COVID-19, and vaccination has been introduced or found by our scientists. In India we have Covaxin and Covishield. We want to test the goodness of it, whether the Covaxin is effective or not. So vaccinated, not vaccinated, affected, not affected. So both are categorical, both are nominal. Vaccinated, not vaccinated, it is independent variable, it is independent variable. Affected, not affected, it is dependent variable, but both are nominal. In that case, we have to apply the chi-square test. So these are the variable tests we are using, and this is how we have to select the appropriate statistical tool, how to apply these tools for our data analysis. So with this, I would like to thank all of you for your patient listening, and the management for the wonderful opportunity given to me. I hope that I have done at least a little justice for selecting me to be the resource person for this session, particularly regarding the selection of appropriate statistical tools for the data analysis. With this, I would like to thank all of you once again. And now the forum is kept open for the participants to ask any questions. Thank you one and all once again.
If you have any queries to be asked, you may ask now or post in the chat box. Feedback in the chat box. Participants are requested to fill it and submit it.
So first of all, on behalf of the program organizer, as the HOD department, on behalf of faculty members, I really thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful presentation. As I said, you started your presentation with a very simple example, like a water tank and a pot and a can. The entire presentation is similar like that. There is no any difficult words to find out. All the concepts are explained in the same manner. Really fantastic. I mean, no words to explain your presentation, sir. I'm not a represent appreciate your presentation. Even though as a learner, I learned a lot of things this presentation. Really, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Now the platform is open for question and answer.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for having selected me as the resource person for this session. Thank you so much.
Sir, really, we are very blessed about for this opportunity, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Dear participants, I know it is getting delay. If you have any queries, you can ask. Our resource person is available always.
Thermally has asked, what is meant by t-test for equality of means, when it can be used? The independent sample t-test, I told you, no, it is used to test the equality of means. So that is the test to be used. That is independent sample t-test. We are comparing the sample means, sample 1 mean and sample 2 mean. So the equality of man, equality of means is tested. Okay, Tanmali madam.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, please.
This is Dr. V.S. Kanchana from Balaji Government Arts College, Tirupur.
Yes, madam, please.
Excellent presentation, sir. According to me, no any other person could have done justice to this topic.
Thank you so much, madam.
I had listened to your session in Bardia University refresher course also.
Oh, you attended. Thank you.
So just by seeing your name, I wanted to attend this one-week program.
Thank you so much.
Excellent presentation, sir. No words to express.
Thank you very much, madam. Thank you.
Each and every learning student can easily understand.
Thank you very much, madam. Thanks a lot.
One question, sir. Factor analysis, exploratory factor analysis, can we restrict the number of factors? If we just give, if we may get more than 5 factors. But is it advisable to restrict the factors like I want only 3 or 4 like that?
It is possible, but it is not correct, because the categorization of factors is made by the tool itself, or the software itself, and it is based on the eigenvalues. So if the factors having eigenvalue more than 1, that is only considered as factor. So in each and every factor, there must at least be 2 or more items. That's why it is advisable to apply factor analysis if you have more than 10 or 12 variables. Otherwise, the number of factors, number of variables in each factor will maybe 1 or 2, it may not be good. So if more variables are there, we can apply exploratory factor analysis.
Okay. For one of my research, sir, I had 23 yes. statements, and I had applied factor analysis, and it was reduced to 9 factors.
Yes. If you increase the number of factors, yes, please.
In it, three factors had only 2 items in it.
Yes.
Okay, sir.
It's okay. That will happen. If suppose if you are increasing the number of variables, the number of factors may also increase. In that case, there could be some 2 or 3 variables in each factor. Nothing is wrong at all. But why we are insisting to increase the number of variables? See, in many cases I have seen in the thesis, for 7 variables or 8 variables are also the some scholars are applying factor analysis. It is not good at all. And it can be tested whether we can apply the factor analysis. We have to test it with the KMO Bartlett test. So KMO yes. Bartlett test is there. It is used to test the adequacy of sampling. Okay, madam.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you
Thank
so
you.
Much.
Thank you very much, madam. Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Please.
Sir, I am Ravi Kumar from Central University of Karnataka.
Please.
First of all, thank you so much, sir, for a very, very, very wonderful lecture, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, I have 2-3 queries, sir. My first query is that, sir, what is the difference between ANOVA regression and the factor analysis, sir? You have explained very well, sir, but I get confused, sir. My second question is, sir, that cost in agriculture economics, sir, cost of cultivation depends on many inputs, sir, like fertilizers and irrigation, electricity, many things, sir. So, sir, which test will be applied here, sir? And my third question is, sir, that if I collected the data, if my sampling technique is probability sampling and I have collected the data through that technique, so is it necessary to only apply the parametric test, sir? You got my question, sir?
Yeah, I got it.
But thank you so much, sir.
Let me answer one by one. You can repeat the questions once again. Once after answering the questions, okay? Your first question? You have to understand the difference between ANOVA regression and factor analysis.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I told you now. Both are similar. The difference is number of independent variables. I mean the number of dependent variables. That is the difference between the regression and factor analysis. In the case of ANOVA, there is only one dependent and one independent. In the case of regression, if it is a simple regression, there is only one independent and one dependent variable. In the case of multiple regression, we can conduct multiple regression if there is only one dependent variable and more independent variables. Like in the case of two-way ANOVA, there are only 2 independent variables. In the case of regression, there can be more than 2 independent variables. If there are more than 2 independent variables, we cannot apply two-way ANOVA, whereas we can go for MANOVA. In the case of MANOVA, more than 1 dependent variable was used. Is it not? But here, in the case of regression, even in the case of multiple regression, only 1 dependent variable, but more independent variables. That is the case. But if the number of variables is quite large, some 15 or 20 variables, then we can go for factor analysis. That is the major difference between these 3 types of tools. Okay.
Sir. Okay, sir. So, sir, my second question is related to this only, sir. That is, yes. In agriculture economics, sir, cost of cultivation depends on many inputs, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. Of course.
So, okay. Can we use the factor analysis here, sir? Or yes. ANOVA, sir?
See, as you told, cost of agriculture is the dependent variable. And how many variables you are comparing? Based on that only you have to go for factor analysis. Suppose if you are comparing some 5 or 6 variables only, then better you can go for a multiple regression. If more than 6 or some 10 or 15 variables are there, then you can go for factor analysis. Okay.
Thank you, sir. One more query, sir.
Yes.
The data collected through the probability sampling, sir. So is it necessary to use only parametric test there?
No, it's not like that. As I told you, no. Whether the data is normally distributed or not normally distributed. So that is the criteria to determine whether we have to apply parametric or non-parametric test. For applying the parametric test, the data must be normally distributed. For applying non-parametric test, whether the data are normally distributed or not normally distributed, we can apply non-parametric test. That is what the criteria. Irrespective of the sampling method, because if you are applying probability sampling or non-probability sampling, that is different. After having collected the data, you have to test the normality. Based on that only, we have to go for parametric or non-parametric test. Okay, sir?
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Very well explained, sir. I'm very lucky that I have attended this seminar, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you very much, sir.
Any more questions from participants?
Sir, good afternoon.
Sir, good afternoon. Hello. Good afternoon, sir.
Very good afternoon, please.
Hello. Sir, can you share your phone number so that if you have any further queries, we can just make a call.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot. I hope I would have been your student in the college, so I would have learned more and more.
I'm blessed to be part of this session.
Thank you, sir. One more request.
In the future also, when you will conduct any type of seminar or workshop, sir, please inform us, sir. Please, sir.
Sure, sir. Definitely. This WhatsApp group will be maintained in future also. So better you stay in this group so that we can post the further information. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay.
Sir, and sir, yes.
Am I audible? Ah, yes.
Your mic is mute.
Madam, you are not audible now.
Sir, one more question from chat box, sir.
So only I attended this workshop, and today I felt really blessed.
Thank you so much, madam. Thank you. Madam, your voice is breaking, madam.
In Malayalam, we used to sell paimbal. In Tamil, taipal. Taipal, pa madri, evlo simple solla mudiyumo, avlo simple sollirkeenga sir. Adhu naan nenicha sir mudichave namakku enna appdi sollite. Ana ungaloda session attend pannadhukku appuram naan edutha subject la naan nenicha evlo easy ah na solli kudutirukena. Ana
Thank you, madam. Thank you. Madam, thank you for your nice compliments. Thank you, madam.
Really great feedback, sir. We feel so happy about the program. Really, the word used by the madam is so fantastic because of such presentation is today. So it's apt for that.
Yes.
Thank you so much, sir. So moreover, one of the questions in the chat box, sir, I think you've seen that. How to test the normality of the data, sir? Asked by Sridevi.
Sridevi, you know, the normality can be tested in by applying several types, right? Several tests are there. Using that, we can apply the test the normality. So using skewness, using kurtosis, using Sakharov-Weil test, then using Kasparov test. So several tests are there. Using that, we can test the normality. Then QQ plots are there. then histogram can be used. So several methods are there. We can have another session for discussing about the normality. Okay.
Thank you, sir. So one more question, sir. What is the minimum number of sampling?
I have already told you on that other day, Balakrishnan sir is asking the same question every day, right? See, the minimum, there is no such a minimum number of error or like that. Okay, based on the significance level and based on the confidence level only it is determined. So there is no specific criteria for the sampling error, sir. Balakrishnan sir?
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir, one more thing.
Yes, yes.
Sir, the way you have shared your information and knowledge openly, I have not attended any such presentation before, sir. Transparently and honestly, you have shared all the information and your experience of so many years. Thank you, sir. It was a very useful session, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Sir, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Sir, please.
Sir, I am Singhu from Ratnam College of Arts and Science, Coimbatore, sir.
Oh, sir. Welcome, sir. Please.
Sir, very, very excellent session, sir. I am a learner of the research, but you provide the knowledge is very wonderful and very informative, sir.
Thank you, sir.
We use in the Rona informative and we use Motor Nolar, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Definitely, sir. We have a record also. We will share that recording link because it is too high of the storage capacity. So once it is complete all the formalities, we will share the recorded link in the WhatsApp group. So stay tuned to the WhatsApp.
Thank you so much, sir.
Good morning. Good afternoon.
Hi, good afternoon, please.
Sir, I'm from Sri Krishna Arts and Science College, sir.
Oh, yes.
So it was very excellent session comparatively other previous 2 days. Moreover, I have attended the NPTEL Marketing Research and Analysis 1. Comparatively this 1-2 hour session, it was very excellent than NPTEL Marketing Research and Analysis 2 that I have attended. It's very excellent, sir. Very excellent. And I have one doubt in this regard, sir. Under parametric test, there is a correlation. And under non-parametric test, there is a chi-square. More or less, the chi-square and the correlation is one and the same direction now, sir.
Yeah, here also we are comparing two variables, but we cannot say that they are same. They are not one and same, right? See, in the case of correlation, there is no dependent or independent variable. The variables are said to be interdependent.
Okay,
but
sir.
Whereas in the case of chi-square test, there is a dependent and independent variable. But here, the purpose is to test the independence, right?
Okay, to test the independence.
That is the similarity between correlation and chi-square test. That's all.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Any more questions from participants? Okay. Shall we go for MOC? MOC?
I would invite Ms. G. Gopika Sri of BCom FMA Department of KSR Women's College to propose the oath of thanks.
The biggest motivation is your own thought. So think big and motivate yourself to win. Very good afternoon to everyone. I hope your day is wonderful. I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the oath of thanks on this memorable occasion. Let me first of all start by giving glory to the Almighty God for making today's occasion a resounding success. First and foremost, I thank our special chief guest, Dr. D. Kumaresan sir, Director and Professor, Department of Commerce, KSR College of Arts and Science for Women, Tiruchengodu, who despite his busy schedule and enlightening us with knowledge, he explained the concept of how to select appropriate statistical tools for data analysis in detail through his crystal clear presentation. Your speech is really charming and awesome, sir, and I hope all the participants in the event surely enjoyed the whole session. My heartfelt thanks to Lion Dr. K. S. Rangasamy sir, NJF, founder and chairman, Mr. R. Srinivasan sir, Mrs. Kavita Srinivasan ma'am, vice chairman of KSR Educational Institution, for gracing us to do this grand event. I thank our well-wisher Dr. M. Karthikeyan sir, principal of KSR Women's College, for his support, vision and commitment. I wish to extend my gratitude to the head of our Commerce Department, Mr. O. Oblikrishnan sir, for his enormous support and guidance. It is very important to thank all the members of our institute. Their combined effort bear fruit, otherwise it would be impossible. They show strong unity and high spirit make this event highly true. I am also very grateful to all the faculties participated in the 7-day visual faculty development program organized by our KSR Men's College, Tiruchengodu. My heartfelt thanks to all the participants for being with us today. Push yourself because no one else is going to do it for it for you. With these warm words and a kind message, we move to the end of the today's session. Once again, I thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Thank you everyone for spending your valuable time with us. A grateful heart is a management of miracles. Once again, I thank you all. Until we meet in tomorrow's FTP by Dr. Dheeresh Pulshrekha on the topic Steps in Data Analysis, Process through Selecting Data Collections, Methods and Sources. Thank you everyone.
Thank you so much, MOC team. Once again, I heartfelt thanks to our resource person and also our director. And apart from that, my guru and my brother, my all, thank you so much, sir, for the presentation. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Oblikrishnan, and all the participants for having given me a wonderful opportunity to share my views on selection of statistical tools for data analysis. Thank you, Lord Almighty, and all the participants for your patient listening for more than
2 hours. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So we will share today's PPT in the WhatsApp group within 1 hour.
Yes, sir.
And we will send that audio link also very shortly, sir.
PPT is to be shared right now.
Right now. Immediately.
I'm going to share. Yes, immediately. Thank you. Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Sir, we will get, can we have the audio, sir? Audio of the recording, sir?
Sir, video is recorded. It will be shared later, sir.
Okay, so one more request, sir. If you have authored any book on this particular statistics methods, is there book, any book you have authored, sir?
Not yet, sir. It's going on. After completing the book, at the time of release, I will let you know, sir.
Definitely, sir. Definitely. Thank you, sir.
Same request on my side also, sir. So it will be, sir. If you publish a book, it will be useful to all of us, sir.
Okay, sir. Sure, sir. Sure, I will do, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir, may I leave, sir?
Thank
you. Yes, sir. You can, sir. Please, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Dear participants, if you complete your feedback link, you can put no issue. Thank you, MOC team, and thank you, faculty members of Commerce Department of KSR Women's College. Thank you for kind cooperation. Thank you so much.
Thank you to you, sir, also, for giving us this wonderful platform, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. We hope we expect kind support in the future also. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much.